All right, I'm going to go ahead and get started now. Does that sound good, Erica? Okay, great. All right, so today, so I've always wanted to host my own TV show. Have any of you seen The View? I always wanted to do a show called Hot Topics. So, get it, yeah. So today's version of Hot Topics is going to be our GOE camp. Oh, I think we just had a small little earthquake here, guys. Oh, that's kind of crazy. So today we're going to talk about GOEs. Generally, I think we kind of talked about this the last time. I like to call on people, so this is a bit different for me to not be able to say, Andy, what are GOEs? I see you, Andy, so I had to call on you. Our GOEs are grade of execution. So we've got more people coming. Our role as judges are basically to, you guys all know this, you've got a tech panel that really kind of judges the levels of what you're doing, but Naomi and I are going to judge the quality of what you're doing. So when we talk about components, we talked about first impressions last time and about all of the things that you can do to make yourself stand out. But GOEs, we're really grading the quality of each of your elements. And so it's a lot of stuff. There's things called bullet points. How many of you are familiar with the bullet points? Do you guys all kind of know what they are? Ah, Sarah, you should get to know them. So I was really kind of fascinated by this because last year I spent some time with some of our skaters at the Salt Lake City Classic, right, Morgan? Where I worked with our junior skaters, our junior international skaters, and some of our novice competitors. And it was really kind of fascinating to know how little you guys actually know about GOEs and the importance of GOEs. So a quick, real, like, simple thing, because I think that this will be a question that will come up a little bit later that we can discuss. When you're talking about the level of difficulty that you guys are wanting to do, because I know you're all trying to get your level four spins and your level four step sequences and your this and your that, because it is our job, Naomi and I, to judge the grade of execution of what you're doing, you might get the level four step. So you get your base value of whatever that's going to be. Let's say it's 5 points. But just because you got a level four, Naomi's very hard on turns. She's really, really, really picky. And she really wants to make sure that every turn hits the music. And if you're not hitting the music, Naomi's very mad at you. So there you've got your big score for your level four footwork sequence. And you're like, yeah, I got it. But then Naomi's like, minus two. Guess whose score just came down from that high level four score? Yours did, because Naomi's a mean judge.
Thank you. So,
you're welcome. So really, like, I think a really great example is like a level four layback. Let's say you accomplish a level four layback, but because you're doing all of these features, and it's really hard. Like, what you guys do to get your levels is like insane. To get that level four, so most of the time the quality of it can be a bit sketchy every now and then. So let's say you get your level four, and then Naomi's in a better mood and she gives you a plus one. And I give you a plus one, and the rest of the panel gives you a plus one. But then Tiffany, Coach Tiffany, who just joined us, goes out and she does this level two layback spin. And Tiffany's just spinning, and it's wonderful, and she's hitting all of her positions, and it's amazing, and it's wonderful. And Naomi and I say, oh my gosh, plus four, plus five. That level two layback spin that got the plus four and plus five just trampled the score of the level four layback that got plus ones. So I think that the biggest point that the biggest takeaway that Naomi and I kind of want to talk about through this little class today is quality trumps quantity. And I think this year, because everyone's getting a little bit later of a start into your season, I really, really encourage you to make sure that you guys, when you get back onto the ice and you're getting ready to compete, really focus on knowing what you can do and doing it really well, because that's how you're going to succeed at the beginning of the season, because you're all going to start running onto the ice and it's going to be crazy and you're like, ah! And so you can either get lost in doing things that are too hard that your body's not ready for, or you can actually start preparing and, you know, like, just do the things that you do really well. Does that make sense for everyone? Yeah? Great.
You guys have to remember too that when Jed talks about quality and quality of your elements, it's also not only going to help your GOEs, but it will also help your component scores too. Because if you have a dying level 4 layback spin, it's not going to match the music. So Jed, what Jed said is true. Maybe I'll be mean judge Naomi and be like, well, that died. It didn't match the music. It also finished after the music ended so they could try to get that level. So not only are you going to get not a great GOE, your component scores will also be affected. So that's why quality of your elements is a huge thing.
That's a very great point, Naomi. That's a really great point. Because when you are doing these elements, you'll see as we start going through some of the bullet points, some of it is musicality. Some of it is like the structure of what you're doing, which it really does handhold both your choreography. Like we can see that elements are actually matched to the music. And if there's something like extra special to it, we notice that. And it does, it handholds, like it's a bullet point to get you a positive score on your actual element. And it's also adding to your scores for your component. So really great point, Naomi. Thank you. Okay, so we're going to go through this really fun presentation that I made last year. Morgan, are you ready? Except for we have to skip the game. I'm sorry, everyone. We had games last year. Okay, DTT. Here we go. Okay, Naomi, are we good?
We are good.
Can everyone see me? Not me. Okay. Grade of execution, GOE. Fun stuff. Okay, so really, it's a scale value here. We can go +5 to -5. I think that this is a really, Naomi, can you be my room moderator? Yes. Thank you. I think that this can be a really confusing situation here because I know as skaters, I'm actually going to pop it. No, I'm going to stay here. As skaters, I know that you always have the intention to get your bullet points. Like I know that you're going to have some footwork going in or your coaches are putting some elements into with the music. Just because you're actually doing one of these bullet points doesn't mean we actually are going to reward it. And this is where I come to the talk of the quality of it. So I know the last time we were here, people are asking about should they be doing jumps with their arms over their head? And what does that count? And how does this count? Blah, 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 blah. Really, it's whatever is enhancing your element. So you might be doing a triple lutz with both arms over your head, but you might be slumped over and it could be a train wreck. And yes, by the standard, you may have hit a bullet point. Like you might have been trying a bullet point, but in my humble opinion, maybe you didn't achieve that bullet point. You might have been trying it, but it didn't succeed. Or sometimes there's simplicity in an element, right, Naomi? Like sometimes like you don't have to do anything super special. Like a bullet point in some of the jumps are just effortless throughout, like good air position, speed in and out of the jump. It doesn't always have to be stuff to get a bullet point. So I think that's kind of the one point to talk about is that there's 7 to 9 of us at any time on a panel. And what I might think is really awesome and great and hard, mean Naomi comes in again. Like, that was so easy. So really, as you start to construct your programs and you start to construct your elements and what you're trying to achieve, you have to remember you've got like 5 different people who have different views of skating and might be seeing something totally different. So it's your job to make sure that whatever bullet points you're trying to achieve are as clear as day. So like if you think that you're going to go for like the revolutions in a spin or musicality in a spin or a jump, like it needs to be so clear, like undoubtedly that all of us will see it. Naomi, do you have anything to add to that?
No, I totally agree with what you say. And the judges, believe it or not, we do understand what a positive GOE, when it needs to be given and when a negative needs to be given. And sometimes we ourselves are given rules basically that, for example, in a short program and technical program, we have to give negative GOEs no matter what. If you do a beautiful double axel in your short program as a senior or a single axel, I can't reward that. No matter if it flew out of the rink and is so beautiful, we still have to give a negative because you didn't do a required element.
Yeah.
So
that's up on the screen now. What? So you can actually see on the screen. So by judging standards, there are certain rules like right here in the top left-hand corner. short program jump, not according to the requirements. We have no choice. Like, we don't get to find the positives in some of the stuff, which we're going to talk about in some other elements. Like, as we start to really think of, as we start to evaluate an element, we get to like evaluate the good and the bad in an element if it goes bad. Like, let's say you're doing a triple X triple toe and you are doing this wonderful footwork going into it and it's musical and you're fast. The triple X goes up perfect and it's great. And then you go into this triple toe that just gets a little bit wonky. In a free program, we get to really think about like, what are all the good things that you did going into it? What were the great things? What were the not so great things? And we get to kind of equal out into a GOE. But in certain elements, like a short program or certain programs, it has to be required. You have to do the required element, and it has to be a mandatory reduction from us. So I hope that kind of helps explain that part of the scoring. Naomi, do you have anything to add to that?
I don't know how you judge and how you start off in your mind of messiness there, but it's very important for me to start off each element is, I'm everything you do leading into that element has already gotten you to a positive. So I'm not looking to take away anything. So don't make me take away things, you know?
Yes. It's great.
We're here to give you all those positive points as possible, because I like doing it.
We all like giving you guys the points. And I think that's a really great point to really talk about. It is very easy for us to point out the negatives. And as you can see in this like whole sheet that I put up here, it's just like negative, negative, negative. It is our goal. It is my goal, most definitely, to find every little bit that I can reward you for in your skating, even in your bad skates. Like, I beg of you just to stay in it, because if you can stay in it, I'm going to stay in it. But it's when you start to check out, or it's when you start to let go, that I start letting go. But I look for as many positives as I can before I start to reduce in your score. And that goes through components as well, right, Naomi?
Correct.
Yeah, we pay attention to all the little details. All right, so enough of the negative stuff. Oh, yeah, here's where we're talking about strategizing. So I really think that you guys already kind of do this, especially since we've got the strategic method here, who's pimping me out. Really spend some time this season, if you do get a late start, to really think about, like, what do you do really well? And strategize to see, like, maybe you don't need to put the hardest stuff into your programs right away. Maybe that's not what your goal needs to be, but it needs to be about quality stuff. So you can kind of see here how scores can equal out. So look at the base value of some of the stuff that you think that you can really just like nail pretty easily, and start to kind of strategize how you're going to put your programs together this season with a later start. So really think about that, because one thing is that, like, internationally, some of our skaters, again, are really not putting enough emphasis on the quality of their elements. Because if you start to go back into some of the protocols, you'll notice that U.S. skaters tend to be lower in GOEs than international kids right now. And so I think it would behoove all of you and your skating to really focus on the small quality things that we're looking for. Yeah? Does it make sense? Am I speaking in full sentences? I'm not even sure.
Every little detail counts.
Yes, it is. Okay. And you guys can't yell at me, so never mind. Okay, so actually, here we go. The one bullet point that is consistently performed, like, to achieve throughout all of the elements, step sequences, jumps, or spins, is going to be effortless throughout. So that is, like, the one bullet point that we look for. So it's the quickest, easiest one. If it's just easy, that's a bullet point. Like, make it look easy. Don't make it look labored. So I have an example here of what some would think might be an easy looking element. I'm not going to talk because you can't hear me when I talk.
Triple flip. Doppio axel. It's not a cry unless you're here at
night. It's not somebody who's seen the light. Okay, so that was like three really easy elements. So does everybody kind of see the how he achieved effortless throughout on three totally different elements. I can't see any of you, so I'm looking at Naomi and hoping that she does this, that everybody,
oh, yeah.
Yeah, Jed, I'm totally listening, and I totally saw it. I think that he is a prime example of somebody who can just make some things look super effortless, and that goes a really long way. So even if it's a simple element for you, like, we will reward it, and that will get you extra points. So just make sure you think about those little things, little details.
Basically, effortless throughout for those that might not be comprehending Jed as much as others is if you watch a jump and if you by any means cringe or just say, oh, you know, like land it, that's not so effortless. So you kind of just need to be like, wow, that was great. That you see no, you know, even if you're explaining this to somebody or one of your friends from school or a coworker and be like, watch this. If you watch them and they kind of cringe or just kind of grip and say, oh, I wonder if they're going to land it, that's probably not effortless. But if they say, whoa, that was cool, what was that? That's a good sign that that's pretty positive GOE right there.
It's true. Again, anytime I do a Bielman, my friends are like, whatever. But then you do a scratch spin and everyone's like, ooh! So I don't know if I like that theory. Okay. Naomi, you're on the door.
Got it.
Okay, great. Let's see. All right. So our next little guy here. Oh, this is our other game. We had a fun little game there. Okay, so now we're going to talk about our bullet points for jumps. So our bullet points. So you remember last time, any of you that were there with us, we played a skater and we were talking about like all of the stuff that we were thinking as a judge, like what turns are you doing, blah, 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 blah. Like so many different things. As you're doing a jump, there's a tick box that goes down in our brain, like, and it is this very list that you see right here. And you have to evaluate really quickly, like, do you have very good height and very good length and distance? Was it effortless throughout? Is there a good takeoff and good landing? Were there steps before? So you really have to, we are responsible for making sure that we are as alert as possible and taking as many notes as possible and just being aware so that we are properly vetting your element. And this is why I say that it can get really kind of sketchy because it's really fast. There's a lot of things to remember here for us to think about, and there's a lot that happens while you're skating. So this is why if you're trying to achieve certain bullet points, they need to be super clear and they need to be very evident, because if I can just see it, if it's just there, it makes my job so much easier. And then I can actually start to think about more of these bullet points versus like trying to like, as Naomi kind of pointed out, like we try. I'm like, well, yeah, they've got a pretty good distance, I think. Like, we try to find it for you, you know? But if I have to sit there and have like this thought process going on during your element, it makes it a lot harder to really figure out if you've done all of these six bullet points. So since the introduction of plus five, minus five, I think we're all well versed in it at this point. Just a quick sampling, like in order to get to a plus four, you actually have to achieve the first three bullet points that you see here on the screen. If your element matches the music and you had a really good takeoff and a really good landing and it was effortless throughout, but for whatever reason, even though you did all those wonderful things, somehow it just had a really bad height and really bad distance, Naomi could only give you a plus three. She is the mean judge that remembers like, ah! Because you didn't achieve the very good height and very good distance. So if any of those first three bullet points are missing in a jump, we are actually held back as to how far we can go in our bullet points, or in our GOE score, I'm sorry. So kind of keep that in mind as you start to strategize and as you start to really become a little bit more familiar and try to incorporate some of these bullet points into your skating this year. Those three have to be present. And it's the same for the spins and step sequence that we're gonna go through a little bit later. It's those first three, make them as evident as you possibly can, okay? Tracy, is there a question? I've got this presentation up, so I...
Yes. Is that what that means? How does the overhead arms in a jump for these how does the overhead arms in a jump for into these six bullet points? Probably where does that fit in?
It actually, so that used to be a bullet point. It is no longer a bullet point. It's no longer a mandatory reward. So we kind of discussed this last time. If an alternative air position enhances your jump, if it makes it look good, if it really does increase the difficulty and it really makes the element harder, we're going to reward that. But it is not a mandatory plus one. And if you have your arms up in your hair in the air and your mom's arms up in the air and your dog's in your arm, like, it's awesome that you can do that. But if it's like a hot mess, like, we're not going to reward it. So like, you've got to make sure that whatever kind of variations you do on spin, step sequence, or jumps, it has to actually be difficult and look good.
You said a key word too, variations. Every jump in your program with your arms over your head is not a variation of jumps. So please remember that. It's very difficult. Yeah. But again, we're going over quality.
There's a lot of kids that like actually can't rotate like this now because
I can't. I fall on my face. So I know it's difficult, but yeah. Can you answer this for the skaters? If you have three of these bullet points, but then you slip off of the landing and fall.
Mm-hmm. So we're going to get there. We're going to get there in just a second because we're actually going to walk. This is where it becomes the equaling out. So if you have actually fallen, let's say that you've done enough that, as Naomi said, she's always looking for all those positive things. And Naomi thinks like, okay, you've done steps into your jump. You matched the music and it had really good air position. And she was at a plus three. And then all of a sudden you have like a freak last minute fall. Because a fall is a minus five, but she was at a plus three, she's going to take minus five from her plus three, which leaves you at a?
Negative two. I don't know how I was supposed to answer. It's a math class too, yay.
People talking, you guys know, a lot of you know me. I like to talk. So we kind of have to do the balancing out. So when you do fall, if you actually fall, there's a mandatory minus five, but we can offset it off of, in the free program, we can offset it by some of the, finding the positive aspects of what you've done. If it's not a complete fall, then that kind of changes the landscape a little because we don't have to go minus five, which then we can't go any higher than a plus two, but we don't have to be in the minuses. So that was like a quick overlay on that one. But if the error is not super, super serious, then it kind of helps out.
Okay. Melissa asked, is this the same for the short?
No. So this is what, Naomi, do you want to talk about that one more time?
So again, when you have your short program, your technical program, things that are required of you, if you do not do them, we are not allowed to give you a positive GOE in any way. In fact, we have to give you up to negative five on most of those. So if you're required to do a double axel for seniors and you do a single axel, like I said, it could be the most gorgeous single axel in the history of mankind. And we still have to give it a negative five because you didn't even try a double.
Yeah. So it really comes down to, Naomi brings up a great point. Like there is a difference between like a double flip and a triple, like some of the short programs you can do a double or a triple flip, throwing it out there. But if there's a mandatory element, like you have to do a double double or a triple double, if you don't do the actual required element, we have no choice but to go into a minus five for you. Yeah, and that's a spin as well. Like if you accidentally like slip off your edge, like it's a minus, but you're able to kind of like save it, but you don't do the actual spin that's required, it's a minus five. So we're kind of hands tied behind our back on that one. In the free program, again, we can start to kind of be a little bit more flexible if you're achieving some really good bullet points in there. Mm-hmm. Yeah? Great. Okay. I've had a lot of fun watching Karen Chen just stand in this position. I have a feeling her hip flexors hurt. But we're good. Let's see. I guess we'll... So as you guys can see, I think that's a really great example of like really nice height and distance. Like the control of the landing was lovely. It was musical. The air position was nice. Like it was easy, right? There was a lot of just really super positive things about it. It might not be the most mind-blowing double axel of your life. It's definitely a beautiful double axel, but I could definitely support myself and or somebody else going into like a high plus three, plus four on that double axel. So I think that's a really good example of just being able to do a nice element easily.
Jed, for you, what would bump that up to a five or a four if you went three? What would bump it up?
I don't know right now. It's just my heart, Naomi. Maybe I would need a little bit. I don't know.
You have no heart.
I know. I don't. Okay. Oh, shoot. We really want to see it. Or this. So, now I kind of want somebody else to talk and tell me what kind of bullet points did she hit? Or maybe people can, does anybody want to type the bullet points that she thinks? Do we need to show the list of bullet points one more time? Naomi, give me the...
Yeah, show the list of bullet points, I think.
Okay. So, very good height, very good length, good takeoff and a good landing, effortless throughout, steps before the jump, or an unexpected or creative entry, very good body position from takeoff to landing, which I think is very similar to the good takeoff and landing, but an element matches the music. So let's watch this element. No, Karen, it's not your turn.
So I think there's like a 1 second delay. Yeah. So I'm just gonna say that was on the music. Just throwing it out there.
Hey, Naomi's giving the skater the benefit of the doubt. She's a nice judge now.
She's a nice judge now.
Where would you guys have scored that? You can type it out for us to see. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think that's a pretty solid, that's a pretty solid element, because then you think about like the difficulty of that element as well. And I think it's really good. The landing for me was like the smallest bit wonky to stop me from a 5, but I would be at a pretty easy 4 for that. What about you, Naomi?
Ooh, I would be at a 4. I didn't see all the connecting moves going into it. The landing didn't bother me, but her body position throughout was amazing.
Ooh, you guys are all getting judging appointments. You're all judging so well.
Yay for seeing the positive. For all you people, for all you guys that wrote +4, what would stop you from going to +5? And Jed gave his point of view. I gave mine. They're both different too.
Mm-hmm.
It's all, how you see, height.
I mean, mine was right, but.
Better position.
Yeah. Yeah, it kind of gets a little bit around, right? Mm-hmm. You could, if you're searching for it, you could like find faults in it, which stops it from being perfect, I suppose.
No, these are all really good. And that's, again, this is why we have our panels the way we do, because every single person that's answered so far has said something different. Okay. Same with Jed and I. We're very like-minded, but some things are very not like-minded and longer landing. Yeah.
Yeah.
These are really good points.
I need to see the points. Huh, yeah. Yeah. Good job, you guys. Nailing it. Okay. Moving on. Mm-hmm. Oh, just want to watch it again. Spins. All right, let's look at our bullet points for spins. So these are actually, I find, Naomi, I would be curious to know your opinion on this, even though I think we've probably talked about it. I find that spins are the easiest place for us as a judge, because we actually have a lot of time to really evaluate what you're doing. But I also think that spins are so hard these days. Like, I watch you guys and I just think, like, back in my day, like, if I even tried like the first two features of what half of you do now, like, I probably wouldn't be walking at this point in my life. So I personally really appreciate a lot of what you guys do to get to achieve your levels. But I do very strongly suggest looking at some of these bullet points to see how you can enhance some of that score if some of those positions do get a little bit more difficult. If you're going through an injury, there's still ways that you can keep up with everybody without always having to have to like break your back. Right. So
a good thing for, if you look at the first three bullet points on these, if you guys have all done spins and you guys know that a slow spin is hard to hold, and you know that a bad position is also super hard to hold. So technically, if you just do a spin that's easy, well, not, I'm not gonna say easy, that you find comfortable, you've already hit the first three bullet points. Because yeah, there's that sweet spot on the blade that you know you can spin on without catching your toe. And you know, once you hit that sweet spot, you've already hit three of these bullet points. So then take the last three and focus the most on those. Because mm-hmm. a spin, it's not like a jump where, you know, you could go up and possibly end it. You know, when you hit your spin, oh no, this is not going to be good. Or, okay, good. Now let's maintain this centered spin. And we all know, right?
Yeah. Oh my God, just relived my skating days with you. Like, you know, when you get in that spin and all of a sudden you're like, whoa, I'm going so fast. This is amazing. I'm so good. And then
it feels good when you hit that spin. You're like, all right, now I'm going to, this is great.
Like, oh, gotta make it around six. We do it.
Yeah. So if you're struggling, then maybe the first 3 points aren't going to be hit, but a good majority of you, I mean, you hit good spins. Mm-hmm. Your spins are, for a majority of the part, pretty good.
Yeah.
Yeah. I enjoy watching spins a lot.
If you're struggling, I'm struggling to give you your score. All right. So those are pretty easy. Does anybody have any questions about any of these bullet points that you see for spins? It's pretty. I think that the one thing that people kind of miss is the matching the music. There's a lot of different things that you can do in a spin. Like when you're hitting some of the positions, there's usually like a ding. And we're very, like, it's so easy to fool us. Like, as we say, like, we're ready to give you points. We're looking for all the positive things. So like, not every, like, you don't have to hit every beat. You don't have to be super musical in it. Like, do a thing, do two things, do like, you know, one position that hits the music. Then Naomi and I are like, oh my gosh, it was so musical. And they're like, we can't get over it. And all you did was like one hand movement, but to us, you like won the Olympics. So, you know, like, we're easily foolable, but we are also noticed when there's nothing there. So think about those sort of like little details in your program. Yeah. Any questions, comments, concerns? All right.
And a fabulous entry into the back camel.
Well, now he's like telling us what we're seeing. Was there a question?
There's actually a question. Mm-hmm. The question was, how do you show originality while still doing the spin correctly? Oh, sorry. How do you show originality while still doing the spin correctly? Doesn't it have to be exactly right? Ooh, this is the tech panel side and the judging side, I think.
Let me read it one more time.
Okay. This is from Sarah.
Oh, where's... Did you send it just to Naomi, Sarah?
Yeah, I did, because I saw her hand raise. So
can I answer it one more time?
How do you show originality while still doing the spin correctly? Doesn't it have to be exactly right?
No, not at all. Because I mean, you, as long as you hit like a certain, like you've got to be at a certain angle, you have to hit a certain position with your body, but that doesn't mean you can't do a varied position to show originality. Originality can also match musical structure. There's a variety of originality, like the way that you could define it. But as far as to get a certain thing, like a camel spin, your body just needs to hit a certain level. But what you do with your body at that point is up to you and whatever your poor limbs can do to really showcase something different.
Yeah. So I think another word to intertwine with originality, Sarah, is varied. Jed said varied. So yeah, once you hit the angles and everything for the tech panel side, for the judges' side, yeah, that's how you do it. Vary your position. Be original that way.
Yeah.
Question.
Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Okay.
And there's one more. Mm-hmm. And it says, did you read something? Did the Russian who did a costume change get a bullet for her spin? I know. I couldn't understand that the first time. I was like, who? I know which one you're talking about.
I would have to, I'm sure she did. Are you talking about for the costume change? Like, was it a bullet point for a costume change for creativity? If that's what you're asking, okay, yeah.
Yes.
I don't know that I would have rewarded the spin for that. As a judge, I might have tried to find
that goes under components somewhere.
Yeah, I would have found a way to say that there was something creative and original about the program and the way that they were creative doing that. I would not have necessarily rewarded the actual spin for that, which is another thing that to kind of keep in mind when we're talking about musicality and things, that let's say something does go wrong in your program, somebody talked about like doing really great things and then falling, like Naomi and I are still noticing that even though we might have had to have given you a minus five on something, but if it did match the musical structure and there were things that were going so well in it, we get the whole component marks to switch over to. But as long as you kept the performance up, that it's really easy for us to say, you know what, like, yeah, we had to give a minus five there, but there were still so many great things that we can see were present in this program. There were steps. It was musical. It was this, which means that you're clearly, there is choreography, there's like content. So we're giving you choreography marks. We can see that there's really good detail, which means that you're interpreting really well. And then you're still trying to emote to us. So then we can give you the presentation or the performance mark. So there's so many ways that we try to find ways to reward, even though you might be getting a negative GOE. If there was like a weird mishap, like we can still find ways to kind of help you as a skater. Yeah. Oh, yeah. Yeah. I know what costume change you're talking about, but I stand pretty solid on my, I would be surprised to hear if anybody gave that an actual bullet point, but I would not be surprised if I were to hear that they gave it creativity to the program. Yeah. Okay. Let me move on. I don't think we need to see Brady spin. So I just think that one thing to talk about that's been like, there's a lot of difficulty in that. She keeps up the speed. And when we talk about effortless throughout, I think that she hits so many different transitional, like varied positions where she's down, she's up, she's this. And really like her speed stays the same if not accelerating. So there's an ease to the way that she's transitioning from those really difficult positions. So I think that when I'm looking for something that's effortless throughout, that if you're able to do all of those things, it doesn't always have to be the prettiest spin, I suppose. It doesn't have to be like backbending and all of that. But if you can like execute that where it's solid throughout and it's really just a strong spin, like I thought that was really great. Naomi, any thoughts?
I agree.
Okay, good. Good answer. Naomi's a really good judge all of a sudden.
You're Ted.
All right, step sequences. What time is it?
4:42.
Oh, that's your time. Okay, we're gonna wrap this up pretty soon. There are step sequences. We'll talk about the bullet points really quickly. So deep edges, clean steps and turns. I think this is one of the biggest things that I start to look for in your step sequences. I actually look for musicality too, I'm not gonna lie. But I really do start to pay really close attention to like what's happening with your feet. Because not only do I get to evaluate. I think that this is such a choreographical moment in your program. And so the show skater in me gets really excited to see what you're going to do to your actual music. But this is like the biggest telltale sign of like your skating skill. Like we can really see here, like what is, and I think Tiffany asked this question about skaters that come out and are like, just skating so fast to like wow us and be like, I'm fast. When you watch somebody that can't control their edges, it's so evident in step sequences. This, like, you really, as a judge, you really can start to evaluate a skating skill here. Right, Naomi, don't you look for that?
Yeah.
So this really starts to handhold on, like, and it's such a long period of your program that, like, we have nothing but time to sit there and evaluate everything you're doing and to really notice the difficult turns and the variety of turns and is it musical and how are you using your body? And like, you know, like we get to really look at a lot of different things. Naomi, is there anything?
Step sequences, you as a skater have so much play in this. And, you know, based on how the rest of your program is going, if you've had a horrible program before this, your face and just your body posture will affect your GOE on your step sequence. So if you've fallen before your step sequence, oh well, this is a brand new, like Jed said, I also too get super excited for step sequences. And sometimes the best ones you don't even know just happened before you. Mm-hmm. You literally are like, wow, that's such nice. That's great. This is a step sequence. Wow. Yeah. This is great. And again, the first three If you get the first three for me, you are most likely going to get the next three, because your control of your whole body, if you have your deep edges and your clean turns, you obviously have control of your body, because your body helps control your edges. So, you know, like I said, for me, the first three bullet points will go hand in hand with the next three, as long as you're on your music and you know, you can, it literally brings up a program from, if it's lower, it can bring up the entire program. Mm-hmm. And the step sequence is very much a show of yourself.
I absolutely, like 100% on everything you just said. And a few quick points that I want to add out there. When we're talking about, when we went to the plus five, minus five, and the arms over the head bullet points and all of that, one thing that changed for us finally was that it's an actual reduction now. So where we talk about the minus five on a fall, it is an actual reduction if your step sequence is not matching your music. So we get to reward it as much as we want, but we actually have to get you a take away at least a minus one if it's not matching the music. And there are just so many missed opportunities with step sequences half the time. And so like when Naomi's talking about like sometimes it just works and you just watch it and you're like, oh, it's magic and it's great. And it really just kind of makes it's a standout moment in a program, or it can be, to make you almost feel like if you do a really good step sequence, I don't care what you've done for the rest of the program, like that was going on so well. That's a lie. I look for everything, but you can really do a lot with a step sequence. And so I encourage you to really pay some attention, because we really notice it's really painful because it is so long if it's not matching the music. I can reward forgive some of like the stiffness every now and then, because I know it's like a long program and you're doing your thing or whatever is happening with your actual steps. But when it's not matching the music, I turn into Naomi and I get really mean. And a little side tip for any of you who maybe you're not an intermediate, novice, junior, senior, maybe you're a juvenile, and coaches out there, a huge missed opportunity most of the time in a choreographic step sequence. Like when it's not a leveled step sequence and you're not having that to get your level four on it, like I can't tell you how many like juvenile programs I watch for just, it's such a missed opportunity throughout, like not only for your bullet point, your GOE scores, but for choreography. I think like if you want to choreograph a great juvenile program, make sure that the choreographic step sequence isn't just about doing hard turns. Like make it interesting, make it match the music.
I think that this year, more than other years, step sequences will actually be a huge thing, and they will spotlight programs because we haven't had the time to work on jumps on ice or spins. But you know, it's like riding a bike, your edge work, you can get that back and you can perfect that if you are having trouble on other things. So I think this year out of all years, step sequences will be a strong point. Mm-hmm. And it will be a focus point to bring back most skaters, honestly.
Yeah. Totes agree, Naomi. Let's see, I think that I love Jason Brown, but we're gonna skip this. Sorry, everybody, I know we're all fans. Sorry, Jason, love you. Okay, so I think this is a really great, we're going back to Patrick Chan for a minute. So I just want you guys to take this in for a moment. So we've just talked about all of the great things that can be achieved in a step sequence. So we're looking for deep edges, musicality, flow, blah, blah, blah. I would like for you to all type in what score you would give this. And if you feel like giving an explanation why, feel free. Everybody's seen the light, it's a call.
Inciampo una sequenza di passi.
Okay, feel free to give some answers. See, I like it. So you guys are all kind of seeing it the way a judge would see it, which is we're trying to find all of the really positive things. So clearly there was an error in it, but it wasn't a serious error, right? It didn't fall. So you really have to, there's no right or wrong answer to this. I believe if I'm correct with the way that it goes now, we couldn't give him higher than a +3 because there was an error in it, but it wasn't a serious error. So those marginal like things to think about, but I think that it's a really amazing example of how he stayed, even with the error, like at the very end, he still brought it home. He was still connected and you're still, he still brought you back into it, even though you're like, oh, by the end, I was still like, oh, this is so great. So not only am I going to try to find every little bit that I could help him with the GOE score, but then by the time it's time for components, I'm going to remember that even with an error, I was still in it. He was in it. We were in it. And that goes a long way. So an error doesn't always break the spell if you don't let it break the spell.
Yep.
Yeah. So that's kind of the closing point on today's hot topics. Quality versus quantity. And again, you've got kind of a later start to the season for everyone. So really start to strategize about what you do think you do very well. And see if you can work that to your advantage as you start to get back into the grind of skating. Don't go too hard too fast. Just look really good. You know, because that's what we do. So I'll definitely open the floor. I think last time it was easiest for typing questions. If you have any questions, feel free. We're happy to answer a few, but that will also kind of wrap up this evening's GUI. Yes, there is. Short program. I believe it's six or eight, I think. I don't know, I'm a judge for a while. But yes, there are, you can find in the requirements where you'll find what jumps are required and all of that. There's actual revolution requirements as well. Meredith, we talked about this. This is a great topic for us for what we are talking about, because little details that we talk about where it's the landing positions, and I think that we kind of found the faults in Caitlin's landing positions, but then like Karen Chen, like it wasn't anything like over the top. She really nice extended chest, toes were pointed, there's a little bit of musicality, it goes a long way, those little details. Like if you're doing a single lutz, for all of you, like Morgan, let's say you go out there and you're like ready for your triple lutz and you go and you do like this honking single lutz, it's like huge. And you hold that landing. I know that like inside you're like, ah! But I'm also gonna recognize that everything that you did was so beautiful in that single lutz that you might've wanted a triple lutz, but I'm gonna give that single lutz a +4 because you can hold the landing. So like make sure that even like the simple things, like little details, even though it's like doesn't mean much to you guys, like we're there to evaluate those things and notice those things, and it goes a long way. And I think that you, there's a lot of throwaway elements out there for all of you. Like I know mine would be like, I probably do like a double toe and be like, okay, bye. But if I were to actually like hold it and like make it a thing, like Naomi would give me a thing. Give me a +5.
Well, I think too, like kind of going on that is whether you think the jump is good or not to your abilities, please don't let the judges or your audience know. Just if you're smiling, smile. If you are not smiling, don't turn it into a frown, because there's been more than plenty of times where I'm like, oh, that was pretty good. And I look at their face. I was like, ooh, did I miss something? Because they don't have a good face. You know, I guess that jump wasn't as great as I thought it, but I have to judge it based on this. But, you know, so then for the rest of their program, I'm going to watch their face being like, oh, all right.
Generally, so
don't give it away.
Yeah, she'll start thinking about your components as well and be like, yeah. Well,
I just own it.
I'm happy, yeah. So Andy, that's actually a really good question. That's not a silly question at all, because keeping a good like centered spin, like the transition between spins, if it's nice and controlled and fast and good, I noticed that that's a bullet point. Like I would give you credit for that. That's not a silly question at all. I know plenty of judges that would actually, if you don't do that, or if it's really lacking in some of those qualities, that they'll actually reduce from there. So that's a really, when you're transitioning from one position to another or from one foot to another, if it's centered and it stays as fast as you were going or accelerates, it's like super bullet points. So if you're getting faster, I'm like, yeah, tens all the way. So yeah, that's absolutely a huge thing. And again, Andy, that's a really, I kind of love that you brought that up, because it's a moment where I just talk about throwaway elements and throwaway moments. Like, if you're focused on those little details, we are going to notice it, and you're going to get extra points for it. Mm-hmm. So yeah. Any other questions?
There's another one.
Ooh.
Ooh.
If it's gonna move. Yeah. Oh, yeah, 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 yeah. It's this is where this comes down to the if somebody has done an element that's that good, they're most likely hitting multiple bullet points. So really, bullet points are, how do I say this without saying it wrong? They're kind of a guideline for us, because again, you might be able to go out and do some easy steps going into your jump, and you might be able to like land it on the music, but it might be like a flat-footed, like I might be able to find so many good and bad things to it that like on paper, technically, you could say my arm was over my head, I landed on the music, I don't know, maybe it was bit, like you can find all the positive things, and you say I had to have a +3 because I did three things. I can very easily say yeah, but and find these three things. So just because, and this is why I say, like, whatever bullet points you're trying to achieve, they need to be clear as day. And generally, if you've done enough bullet points, you're really already kind of getting yourself into that +3, +4 zone. Like, you're already scratching the surface if we're noticing that much to get that high. So yes, it doesn't have to be by the book necessarily, but it should all be very identifiable for us to justify our score.
So Dan, to answer, in my opinion, for your question, if you do one of the top three exceedingly well, it's literally going to bring up the other two bullet points. I think that's kind of what Jed was saying too. If one is exceedingly well done, the other two have to be brought up. So your GOE will be fine. One might totally shine, but the other two will be there too, in my opinion. You know, if you have good flow into and out of a jump, it's obviously going to have good distance and good height too. So, you know, if you do one exceedingly well, the other two won't shine as much, but they will shine too. So
yeah, you look at that list, and as skaters, I think you can all recognize that generally, like if you're doing one generally can't be present without a few of the others.
Yeah. So your words exceeding and well, yeah, that's, you'll be rewarded for sure. From me, a nice judge.
Hey, you're nice at the end of this. Because Naomi's like the nicest judge you could ever find.
Sometimes. Do you look at coaches at all during the program? No. I don't, unless they're making obscene gestures that catch my eyes as a skater passes by them, or yelling really loud. I've seen that actually. But no, I concentrate.
Yeah, during the program, no, you got our focus.
Yeah, you it's all you guys.
There's too much going on. Like, we have to evaluate so much. There's too much. I can't focus on anybody else. Sometimes I'll watch them, like, before and or after, though. They're kind of funny. They're hilarious. Anybody else have any question? Generally, on the under rotation situation, it's a pretty serious error.
Yeah.
When it's called. There's a level of our judgment on some things, but if it was really called under, you're not really going to see any plus. I'm trying to think of, like, there might be an example out there of how you could potentially get to one, but I can't think of one off the top of my head. So
if it was in a combination, and your third jump in the combination might have been a little bit under rotated. Maybe if your first two jumps were amazing.
I'm not gonna lie, there was one competition I went to, somebody did a three jump combination and all three jumps were downgraded. And I thought about, like, giving it a -4 and not a -5, because, like, that's a skill. Like, that's a really hard skill to be able to
stand up for three times.
Yeah, and to, like, be able to land it with that speed and, like, have control, like, that's good. I don't know.
If you do a really nice jump and you step out of it, you can probably still get a positive. It depends, again, how many bullet points you achieved before you stepped out of it.
Yeah, I think that Caitlin is a great example, because I think that we all kind of found like a weird thing about it, the triple flip, triple toe. So I think that that kind of goes in hand with your question, Andy, is that if you've done something well, we're going to find all the good stuff. And if there's something kind of glaring about it, then we have to figure out like where on our scale does that kind of reduce where we would have gone if it had been perfect and didn't have the weird glaring issue, like where would I have been to where do I think that the present issue should affect your score? Yeah.
And again, the way you worded that, Andy, doesn't look good to you. That's a good actual wording of it, because a judge could say, I think that looked fine to me. And the judge sitting at the other end of the panel could say, well, it didn't look that good to me. So your scores, your GOEs will be based too on viewpoints, literal viewpoints and figurative viewpoints. Because sometimes if you're sitting at the end of a panel, it's really hard to see double lutz jumps, whatever. And sometimes that's a strategy of a coach or a choreographer to do that. So, I mean, we reach and look, but our viewpoints are different based on where your elements are and based on how we see you skate. So yeah, it might not look good to me, but it might look great to Jed, and our GOEs will reflect that.
Because I'm a nice judge. Cool. Any more questions? Did we learn so much about GOEs? So you're all gonna read that list. It's all gonna become like your thing. You're gonna live by the list of GOEs, right? Because I'm gonna go practice mine right now when I get off of this call. I'm gonna practice my pins. And Naomi's gonna judge me. You can see her little judging thing behind her.
For sure.
We're ready for this. All right, everyone. Well, if that's everything, that's fun. Thank you guys for coming. I appreciate it. This was fun. Doesn't beat being in the skating rink, but you know, it's a close second.
My videos.
Thank you so much. Thanks, Naomi. Yeah. Thank you for being a guest judge.
Thank you. Bye.
Bye, guys. Thank you.
Thank you. Bye.
Thank you.